Welcome to the Center of Light Radio with spiritual teacher, intuitive, musician, composer, and best-selling author of The Divine Principle, Anchoring Heaven on Earth, your host, Keith Anthony Blanchard.
Spring has sprung. Welcome to the show. Monday night, 6 p.m. Eastern Time. You can find me here, sitting in the captain's chair, conducting all the affairs of the heart. My name is Keith Anthony Blanchard, and this is the Center of Light Radio, Center of Divine Unfoldment and Reinforcement. It's radio for the soul, y'all. The music you hear before every broadcast of Center of Light is Lavender Soul, my spiritual group. If you want to know more about that music, you can contact me at keithanthonyblanchard.com. Last week, I was doing a Burst of Light live vid feed, and it just got all messed up. There was an audio thing that was happening from hell, and it was just not pretty. So we're going to repeat that broadcast. I'm not sure. It may be tomorrow. I'd say I'm probably going to go with Wednesday. You go to facebook.com/Keith Anthony Blanchard. I'd say 8 o'clock. If you get there at 8 o'clock and you don't see that live feed, refresh my page a few times. It'll finally stick and, come into the forum, I guess you can call it, where everybody wants to ask questions. Be a part of this wonderful program. This week, we're going to be talking about, avatars, God on earth, people who have come to earth, in the form of God consciousness, those who are here and those will be coming. I have a fantastic slide presentation ready for you. I also have some really, really cool videos about the power that some of these avatars bring in. Also, my friend, Mr. Kenneth Pass, who was on Center of Light Radio just a while back, he did a show about aliens and time travel. When he was a young boy, he was picked up and brought back 10,000 years. It's a compelling story. But just to let you know, if you go to centeroflightradio.com, look on the opening page, you will see, once the page settles down, you're going to see a little flying saucer fly across the screen and land. And then you will see a donate button. And the purpose of that donate button is, Kenneth is a very, very simple guy. I believe the guy. I really do. He's a very, very simple guy. And we're going to create a fund razor to get him some money so he can travel, listen to this, to the Hopis and the Pueblo, so he can go find this alien artifact that he buried, that they have tried to find, the aliens, that is, had tried to find Kenneth, so they can find out where he buried this thing. He wants to travel to, I think, somewhere in Arizona, to find this artifact so he can bring it to the Hopi people himself, because that's where it belongs. So we're trying to raise some money for him. I think he wants to do it by bus, and it may take a couple of $300. My goal is we raise $500 for the guy to go there and do what he needs to do. And once he is done with this journey, he's going to come back on Center of Light Radio and tell us how that all went. What a cool thing. So again, go to Center of Light Radio. Look on the opening page. You'll see a flying saucer right next to it. Click the donate button and send what you can. That'd be appreciated. I'm sure Kenneth would appreciate it very much as well. Still hoping to hear from Nucleus 8 about coming on the show. That's my alien human hybrid friend. No luck there. I have a bunch of adverts, but you know what I want to do? I want to actually kind of put those off for now. And if any time you are listening to Center Light Radio, what you always do, and you hear loyally, and I appreciate it, you hear this low rumble in the back, check it out. I live near a train station, an industrial train station, but you can bet I'm in the process of looking for a house, a little quiet, somewhere tucked away from all this industrial stuff that I live by. I live by steel workshops, and oh my gosh. I have a fantastic show for you. This guy that by the name of Andre Atabaki, I found him last year on YouTube, and I strongly suggest to continue to take in what this guest is about. When you get the chance, go to YouTube and look up The Bible of Mithra. It's spelled M-I-T-H-R-A. And you will know that this is the particular video, because it's going to say, I think, the Persian astrologer. Wow, wow, wow. This guy captivated me immediately. I was immediately pulled in with the information. And I couldn't wait to sit here in this chair today to have this interview with this guest. Let me tell you a little bit about Andre Atabaki. Today's show is called Self-Realization Through the Science of Light. Center of Light Radio, I guess we're compatible. Andre Atabaki's unique approach to the exploration of consciousness encompasses a step-by-step approach that blends the best of originality with time-honored traditions. Andre has a wide range of experiences that include cosmology of the Mithras, Persian astrology, and Ayurvedic medicine. His mission is to bring clarity and focus to those who wish to operate within their highest capacity. You can find more about my guest at www.persianastrology.com. Welcome to Center of Light Radio, Mr. Andre Atabaki.
Thank you for having me, Keith.
Brother, as I mentioned just before your bio, when I saw that hour video, I was leveled. I mean, seriously, dude. And this is not just pumping you up for good ratings and making for bells and whistles for this show. Is that how you pronounce it? Mithra, is that right?
Mithra, yes.
It seems to me to be unlike any other type of thought that I've ever heard. It seems very, very unique, and I love it. How did you come to learn about Mithra or Mithra? Is it part of your bringing up because of where you're from, sir?
Yes, partially that is true. But also during my life and my journey throughout the Middle East, Europe, and United States, for some reason I've been thrown into this tradition. I've been exposed to Mithraism throughout my life. But yes, my family is also part of it.
Can you tell me how Christianity came from Mithra?
You know, Keith, I'm not a historian, and there are plenty of books, articles about what has been borrowed in Christianity from Mithras. But I try to stay away from that particular topic and focus more on the central ideology of the tradition. But just to briefly touch on that subject, you know, Mithras go back to about 6,000 years. And it's a tradition that started in a culture called the Vedic civilization. And from there, it became a part of the local traditions, which later became Persians, Armenians, and also, according to some of our history books, Celts also lived in that area. And this tradition was later carried to the Roman Empire. It became one of the main religions of the Roman elite. So Christianity has borrowed many traditions from Mithras. For example, the sun god has 12 companions. And in the old days, you know, around Christmas, winter solstice, the sun would disappear for about 3 days, and then it would resurrect again in the sign of Virgin. And people would celebrate with wine, medicated wine, and baptism. So yes, these are all part of the pagan traditions that were borrowed by Christianity, and there's quite a bit more. But yes, there's, you know, the listeners can do research online. The only thing is that nobody talks about the central or the essential ideology of the practice. And as you have watched the video, towards the end, we come to the realization that history is nothing other than part of the matrix that we're experiencing here and now. So
yeah, and I appreciate your position on wanting to stay away from that arena into that place. I totally get it. One thing I really, really begin to salivate on as I'm watching this video is you start talking about awareness and how it is the absolute central, it's so essential and subjective awareness. Let's talk a little bit more about that, because that is absolutely one of my favorite subjects to talk about.
Absolutely. So a lot of times I compare a human being to an automobile in the sense that when you look at an automobile, what is an automobile? Is it just the tires or the seats or the airbag or the engine? Or is it all these components intelligently assembled and designed so that it can take you from point A to point B? So when you sit in meditation, you realize that we as human beings have many different aspects to our essential nature. For example, we have a physical body, and we have many other aspects that are not visible to the naked eye. We have intelligence. We have a storage house of memory. We have a third of our life is spent in the dream realm. We have awareness. We have consciousness. We have willpower. And all these invisible components that are not visible, and the traditional science doesn't have the proper methodology to understand them, can be understood through what we call the science of light, or a Mithra.
And those invisible qualities that you had just mentioned, those are the more real aspects of ourselves, yes?
I would say absolutely. Once you, if you think about it, we spend one third of our life in sleep. The two third that we are awake, how much are we really present of the outside world? Most of the time, we're in the field of our imagination, in the field of our own thoughts, past memories, future hopes, desires, fears. We spend the majority of our life inside our own head, so to speak. So when you really do the math, yes, we spend way more time on the internal world than we spend outside.
So there's the three intermittent states, awake in the physical world, and at night we go into the unconscious, and then we transition into the dream realm.
Exactly. And our life continues through these three cycles.
So just taking it all in. Go ahead, brother. Please continue.
So what connects these three stages, the field of psychology tells you that it's memory. But when you really sit back and observe this phenomenon, it's the awareness that connects all three mental stages, the so-called awake, and then we go to the dream stage. Part of that is dreaming, a part of it is being unconscious. So what connects all these three stages is awareness, and awareness is always in the background, and it's the primordial aspect that holds everything together. But talking about it is one thing, but this science is not about talking. It's about what I like to refer to as the Jane Goodall, becoming the Jane Goodall of consciousness. Jane Goodall went to the jungle and sat there for 30-some years and just observed the chimpanzees. And she wrote her findings. And so science of light, or Mithra, is about becoming the Jane Goodall of consciousness, sitting down and observing this phenomena that we call me. And as you do that in the morning, at night, we have a methodology to this madness. And what happens is that you become detached and you become more aware of your own awareness.
So you awareness get to awareness, yes. Yes.
So you sit in the background and you observe, you become the observant of this organism, I call me. He wakes up in the morning, he does his deal, then he goes to sleep. And all the time you're aware of all these three stages. And you're like a scientist, you start dissecting and basically taking notes, just like Jane Goodall, of the anatomy and the physiology of existence, the construct of the universe, so to speak.
So essentially, awareness is who we are.
Well, to say that we're not just a physical body is also incorrect, because we're all of it. And I'm not only this physical body. Once you really become the Jane Goodall, then you realize that all bodies are also your bodies, that the universe is also an extended me. And yes, I am consciousness. Yes, I am awareness. But I am the totality of what makes me me, or what makes you you.
often when I work with people to get them to expand their awareness, I have them pretend that throughout their day that they're just a ghost observing the world, that they cannot participate. And I've had some pretty phenomenal results from people practicing this particular methodology. So, Andre, what happens to us when we die?
Based on my observation, I can make a guesstimation, but nobody knows for certain. But from what I mean, to say otherwise, I don't know, maybe I'm not at that level, but it seems like consciousness cannot die. It's a form of energy, like electricity, and it has to continue in another form and in another dimension, so to speak. So, but essentially, our body is like a garment, and at the time of death, you lose the garment. And when you observe yourself, you realize that there's a lot of pressure on this physical body. There's gravity that's pulling you from core of the earth, and there's the weight of the atmosphere on your shoulders. All the other stresses of life aside, all the constraints of the physical body aside, as soon as you die, you are free. You will become as light as a feather. And it's a freedom that I think if most people would have tasted that type of freedom, they would never be afraid of death.
Mm.
So the science of light, or mysticism in general, I would say in any tradition, will make you aware that this life is nothing but a breath. I mean, forget about all these metaphysical and spiritual stuff. Let's look at it from a Western perspective. A Western scientist says that our solar system has been around for billions of years, right? And the span of a human life is what, 70 years? So what's 70 years in comparison to billions of years?
Non-existent.
Non-existent. It's just
did I make the A plus?
Yeah, absolutely. That's graduation
so
right there.
It's so small of an increment, it literally pretty much doesn't exist at all.
Yes, and it's gonna happen so fast, but you know, while you're in this domain, the experience of time, space, continuum is very convoluted. So in the spiritual realms, which is, you know, essentially a form of death, because, you know, you will wake up and you realize that this whole life of what I'm experiencing or what you're experiencing is nothing but just a breath. It's just a moment. And this no longer is not a theoretical knowledge. It becomes a part of who you are. And you're aware of that nothingness every moment of the days. And so when you're in that state, you know, it's just like a body, like a piece of clothes that you're going to change at the end of the day.
You know, you were talking about, Andre, having mystical experiences as why, if we can all have more of them, we would shed our fear of death. And I, being very fortunate to play in the cosmic arena, often very consciously aware, hyper aware, if you will, even sometimes more aware than I am sitting in this chair talking on this microphone, which has alleviated so much fear about my passing. In fact, I don't have a fear of passing. The only thing I'm really concerned about is my son growing up with a father. Other than that, I'm all good. So I'm curious, if I can, without being personal, knowing about you practicing Mithra for as long as you have, how are your nightly excursions, sir?
Same as you. Very, quite similar. The only thing, you know, that I would be concerned about is my son and my family. Other than that, there's no... You know, I'm already a dead man. I always tell, I'm not even, I mean, this whole life becomes a an illusion. So what is death and what is rebirth and what's, they all kind of lose their meaning in the ultimate sense.
I was watching your video today just to kind of get brushed up on it for tonight's interview. In the video, you said, nobody knows how to go to sleep. I never thought about that. And then you said, all we can do is hope that the Lord of Sleep comes to us. When nature is ready, she will absorb you and swallow you into herself. I was like, wow. Wow.
Yes. So the experience of mysticism is essentially the same thing. We're all mystical beings. We're all spiritual beings. It's just that, you know, our attention span gets a little bit more caught up in the material existence. But essentially, we're all spiritual beings. And it's just a matter of where you want to put your focus and attention.
So do we come here just for the fun of it? Just because? Or did we have a hiccup in our consciousness back then and we found ourselves solid, separated consciously from the rest of universal awareness?
I think the common theme amongst all of us is that we want to experience this, even if it's hardship that we're experiencing. You know, the whole grits of life, it kind of pulls us in. We want to experience it. And that's why we're here, the experience of it. Maybe each life could be considered like a trip in the mind of the divine. And it's just a moment.
That was phenomenal. I like that. You know, it's like you said, talking about we wanted to come here to experience even the denser, heavier, painful stuff. You know, I often liken that to an amusement park. And when people go to amusement park, you know, what do they ride, the Ferris wheel or the roller coaster?
Exactly.
They'll get on the Batman roller coaster and ride it, you know, with sweat and buckshot and a white knuckle on the seats. Exactly. You know, and we like these kinds of rides, yeah?
We do. We're kinky beings. And the sooner we accept it, the better. You know, even when we're experiencing hardship, when your mind expands, and because all your hardships are really the hardships of your physical body, security, growing up, old age, disease, any issue that you have, any constraints that you have, is really of that of your physical body. Every day when you get up, you got to, you know, take a shower, clean it, and then feed it, and then go to work, make money so that you can feed it some more. And then you get tired, then you have to sit down, then you have to get up. Any problem that you have is that of your physical body. So when your awareness grows beyond the physical body, then the challenges of life are not going to bother you. You become very grateful because you know life is nothing but a moment. And for having that moment, for having those experiences, you become so grateful instead of, you know, getting caught up in the drama of the hardship that you're experiencing or your body's experiencing.
And parallel and ironically, but all that altogether, it seems to help some of those bodily problems not ever show up in the first place because there's a shift in intention and a shift in awareness of where your focus is. And as we are creating, we begin to pull in new experience because we're no longer body identified.
Absolutely. I think stress is one of the greatest factors, the greatest causes of disease. The experiences that we have, the stresses that we have now, you know, they don't necessarily translate to disease right away, but they do get accumulated in different parts of your physical system. And depending on, you know, where the weaknesses are, essentially they will settle in those places. And over the long term, they will cause physical problems. So yes, stress is a huge factor in health. Diet is another factor, and also lifestyle. Are your rhythms the same with the sun, or, you know, are you a night owl? So all of those factors affect our health.
Night owl.
Exactly.
You're a night owl?
No, I'm not. I'm a follower of the sun.
Great. Yeah, I'm a musician. So for the last many years, it's been the night hitch for me, the graveyard shift. Let's put it that way. But I don't want to use the word grave in that context. That's for sure. If we could, let's talk a little bit about intention. To me, intention is everything. Whether you're where you're intending or not, we are intending. So we might as well get with the deliberate conscious program of it. Yes?
Well, intention in what sense? In sense of creating something in terms of manifestation, or in what sense are you referring to intention?
Just becoming aware of oneself and how we are constantly bringing forth thoughts that come back. I would say creating, yes, because, you know, like, for example, if someone wakes up in the morning, they go to work, they don't really think about the process of getting out the bed and eating some cereal, whatever it is they're going to do, brush their teeth and do all this and walk into the car step by step, putting the keys in their car. And as they are subconsciously intending, their life begins to unfold.
Exactly. Yes, absolutely. You need to become a part observer. And that's nothing really hard to do because a witness is part of who you are. Without having a witness, you cannot even exist, like you cannot exist without the sun. So yes, you need to, you know, if you're interested in growing and becoming more aware, yes, your intention should definitely be on awareness and observing yourself at all times of the day.
Keith Anthony Blanchard, host of Center of Light Radio, 6 p.m. Eastern Time. I'm here in this chair today. My guest is Mr. Andre Atabaki, and we are talking about lots of really cool stuff, lots of my favorite stuff. The subject for today is self-realization through the science of light. Mr. Andre, would you give out your contact information to our listening audience and anything you want to bring forth that you would like them to know more about you and what you were doing, sir?
Yes, sir. My website is PersianAstrology.com. And the reason is Persian astrology is because the science of life and light is basically the main science of our tradition. And as we come to this realm, we experience we become constrained by the space continuum, which is the science of time. So astrology is the science of time. So it's an offshoot branch of mysticism, which is what I do partly. I do consultations, and I also do a couple of different talks. One is about choice and science of decision making, and that book or that program is called From Choicelessness to Power. I also have another program called The Galaxy Within, which kind of takes you through a step-by-step approach to the exploration of consciousness. And last but not least, the Bible of Mithra, which is the essential philosophy of mysticism in general. And there's also the video, as you mentioned, on YouTube. The video is a little different than the book itself. It's more for, there's no... You know, the book itself is a little bit more mystical, so it's written in a way that it would bypass your subconscious mind. It's kind of devotional and spiritual, whereas the video is more logical. It's like, here you go, it's pretty intense because, you know, I've put a lot of information in 1 hour of video, and this type of information requires quite a bit of time to absorb. So,
yeah, you know, I had to go back through the video that I was talking about earlier quite a few times. I heard everything you said, but it, you know, and it all started to begin to register. But after I heard it the second, third, and fourth time, certain things begin to really coalesce and begin to integrate into an aha fashion versus the initial aha. It kind of began to seed itself. 888-919-2355, 888-919-2355 is the number you dial to get on the air to speak to myself and my guest today, Mr. Andre Atabaki. And I love the title of your, the subtitle of the Book of Mithra, A Book of Clarity. Wow, wow, wow. Keith Anthony Blanchard here with Center of Light Radio to remind you about my lifelong work, RPM, Recognize, Plug In, and Manifest Your Life. Let me ask you a few questions. What is it you want out of your life? You want more financial stability? You want relationship? You want greater degrees of bliss, conscious expansion, and spiritual evolvement? These are magnificent, wonderful things, and I have achieved all of these by implementing what I am offering to you so you can apply this to your life so you can have all those things that you truly desire and truly deserve. I absolutely guarantee my work 100%. Go to Center of Light Radio, look at the opening page, the bottom right-hand corner of your screen. Not only will you receive my awesome Power Pack newsletter monthly, but you will have access to my RPM program. Stay in touch with me, and I will send you everything I'm about, all my successful works. You can bet. All you have to do is contact me, KeithAnthonyBlanchard@gmail.com. Peace, love, and light to you always. Andre, let me ask you this, sir. In the video that, again, I'm going back to this video because this is how I discovered you and this is what's creating this dialogue, most of it. You talked about how, this one really hit me pretty good. You talked about how our thoughts are not our own. And it seems very convincing now. It seems very, very real that I'm Keith or I'm John or Jane Doe and I'm sitting here and I'm using my think tank, right? And I'm going to create this thought because this is what I think about that person or this thing or the other. But you said in this video, our thoughts are not our own.
Yes. And that's a strange subject for many people because they claim ownership. Right. They always claim ownership that I create my thoughts. And, one would always go back to what is this I that you're referring to? Because your thoughts could shift drastically depending on your lifestyle and your diet and even your spiritual practice. And as I mentioned in the video, your consciousness is like an airport. So depending on your practices, your lifestyle, your diet, your basic personality, you attract certain type of thoughts. They're really
yeah,
not.
You know, I'm aware that I'm not my thoughts. And I'm also aware, Andre, that I recognize as the observer that sometimes thoughts move through my mind. But when I heard you speak about that in the Bible of Mithra video, that none of this comes from what I've been claiming is me in the first place.
Exactly. Because thoughts are, think of them as airplanes that are just flying all over the earth. And if you're interested in them, they will land in your consciousness. But that doesn't make them yours. It's just that there's a mutual attraction. And a lot of times we're enamored by our thoughts. We want to, hold on to them. And
that's when they begin the real process, the realness process. When we grab a thought, it begins to anchor itself. And therefore, the wheels begin to be put into motion and it begins to manifest in our life in the moment that we grab them, correct?
Absolutely. They become a part of our imagination.
Yes, yes.
Part of our infatuation. Wow. So in the practice of mysticism, you just let go of everything. And when you no longer, when your thoughts become like cars on the freeway, you have no emotional attachment. If you're looking at the freeway from a mountain, you have no attachment.
It's a road rage thought.
So you're just looking at it from far up there. And that's actually a very important stage because it takes you to the next level of spirituality. It allows you to become objective and start really seeing and observing different layers of the construct of this universe. So it's an important stage. And that's where a lot of folks who start meditation just go crazy. Because we have no idea how many thoughts are passing in the sky till we close our eyes and just become quiet. And at that point, you may think like, oh my God, I'm going crazy. These thoughts are just all over the place. So the field of thought is a very tricky field. And
it would be absolute infinite. And from every kind of vibrational thought, as dense as possible to as light as possible, it's all in this particular dimension, would it be? And the fact that we move, is that what meditation is for? At least one purpose of meditation so that when we finally do, quote, ascend in a particular meditation session, we move through the ceiling of thought.
Exactly. Very well Wonderful. Said. Yes. So yeah, the thought, the realm of thought has to be transcended. Meaning,
So I'm sorry, Andre, but the good thoughts is not really the prize. People think, you know, we have a devil and an angel on our shoulder, right? They think we know the devil is devilish, but are we quite so sure the angel on the other shoulder is not the same devil in disguise? So they think that the thoughts that are good in nature, of course, that's kind of a guide that we use to move about, navigate through life. But that's not the golden ring. The golden ring is it's to get above all that in the first place, right?
Absolutely. And one of the other points that I bring up is that even when you have a good thought, for example, say you want to clean your house so that your family enjoys their house. So that is a good thought, right? But you need to become aware of the dirt or the opposite of that good thought. So say if you're concerned about morality, you must see immorality. So even if your thoughts are good, if you really look, there's always the opposite right there. So there's no good or bad. I mean, day and night have to come together. Good or bad, or who's to say what's good, what's bad? They're just part of the same thing. Death and life, they're the essential aspect of each other. So you can't have one without the other. But in transcendence, none of it really matters. It's all temporary. It's just the breath.
Yeah. And, you know, I use the analogy often about right and wrong, good and bad. Here's a baseball bat. Is that good? Well, yes, people have fun. They play recreational sports. Well, no, not really. Last night, this bat killed someone. Oh, that's bad. Well, no, not really. The reason the bat was used to kill someone is because it was protecting a woman who was being attacked. Well, that's good. And we can play this nonsense game back and forth. And it really goes nowhere but except further into the realm of duality.
Exactly. And a lot of religious folks, they start, you know, taking a whip and just going at it because they have some supposed evil thought. I mean, you know, that's not how you transcend your evil thoughts. You transcend it by observation, not by hitting yourself or, you know, by going through these extremes. But, you know, as long as you take your thoughts to be your own, that's, you know, You'll have some challenges, mental challenges, physical challenges, spiritual challenges. So yes, the transcendence, I think, is the key of making yourself a whole, you know, bringing all the levels of your being, align everything as one. So there's no, you know, sometimes, like, for example, in religious thought, they tell you, you know, love your neighbor, but you know, that's a good thought, but on an emotional level, are you really going to love your neighbor? you know, there's always this conflict between different layers of our own being. So spirituality, it kind of aligns all the layers. There's congruency, there's fluidity, and there's just ease of being.
Andre from the chat room, Don Danny asked a question. What about out-of-body experiences?
I think our whole life, this whole body is an out-of-body experience.
I can see Don Danny laughing.
So, yes. Yeah.
It's basically simply just an awareness shift, right?
That's all it is. It's just an awareness. It's just so simple. The whole thing is so simple. And we have to make everything so complicated. But the whole thing is very simple.
In fact, I did a live feed the other night, and my whole gig was about simplicity. Life is not hard. It's not hard. And I often say, get out of the fight. It's not hard. Let's see. What about the grand scheme of the waking dream?
I think the three states that we talked about, the awake, sleep, unconscious, these are all different. They're just misnomers. They're just titles. But there are different levels of being sleep, because one of the points, as you know, I bring up in the video, is when you become an awareness, when your awareness shifts completely into awareness, and you observe yourself or you observe this organism go to sleep. What happens? How does a dream come to be? Is it like a software that's, you know, getting turned on somewhere? Or when you really look, it's like a three or a multidimensional experience that comes into being from the core of your own self. It's like a hologram that just comes to life. And you suddenly can have all kinds of experiences. You can be in a beautiful beach and enjoy the ocean, and the experience is going to seem so real. So similarly, when you become the observer and you completely move to the background, you realize that, you know, I'm not in the world, you know, so to speak, but the world is in me. It is literally a projection that happens within myself. So all these three states are nothing but sleep. They're just a moment, just a breath. That's all. And when you awaken, you realize that moment is nothing but just a moment. That's all it is.
A bit ago, we were talking about out of body. In Buddhism, they say that let's use meditation, for example. As soon as you hold a thought, say you want to go to Hawaii. When you hold that thought, you are in Hawaii. In that moment, you are. And the quote trick becomes, the more oomph you can put behind the thought is what will congeal the experience into to a more tangible fashion. So much to the point that if you are a master, or whatever term a person would want to use, or really good at it, how about that, that you can literally project yourself not only out of body wise, but begin to materialize a form.
Yes, that's a that kind of reminded me of a story. I had a friend, an acquaintance. He was born in a very, very rich family. We're talking about like the billionaire level.
Wow.
His father.
Nice friend to have.
yes, acquaintance more so. But I really observed. I really enjoyed observing his life, because he lived a good life. And he ruined many businesses that his father built for him. The last of it was a bank in Switzerland. So finally, he said, you know what? I'm done with this world, and I'm going to go to the Himalayas. I'm going to go meditate there for the rest of my life. About 12 years later, he came to San Diego. And I went to see him, and I said, so what brings you back? And he said, my brother has passed away in Switzerland, and I am here to get my inheritance, but I'm having all kinds of legal problems. So I visited him a few times, and one day when I went to the house to see him, he was meditating, and there were a few other folks that come there to also see him. And they're like, what are you doing? He's like, I'm meditating. I'm trying to solve these legal problems. And one of those attendees is like, dude, this is not how you do it. I will show you. I will demonstrate to you how it's done, because I'm an international attorney. And so he started making calls to Switzerland. And I say within a span of about 30 minutes, he fixed all his legal problems. And he's like, you see, this is how it is done. And our friend said, well, if you hadn't seen me meditate, maybe you would have not made that phone call. Maybe it was my meditation. Is it the egg or is it the chicken?
Right.
Which goes back to your story. Yes.
Lord Mithra, the source of light, and Goddess Anahita, the source of consciousness. Tell me about that.
Consciousness and awareness are always joined together. I mean, you can't experience life without these two components. So consciousness, if you think of yourself as an electrical component, you know, you cannot operate unless you're connected to electricity. And consciousness is like that electricity. It breathes life. It gives you this light, so to speak, to see. And awareness is what holds that consciousness. So on the physical realm, that translates into the duality, the sun and the moon, the night and the day, man, woman. and all the duality that we see in life. So that's essentially a part of our experience. But awareness itself does not have any qualities. It's just in the background, holding everything together. So you can think of it, if you look at an egg, the shell is very thick, and it's not really, all it does, it just holds the egg itself. It holds it together. So think of awareness like the shell of the egg and everything else inside as the egg.
Wow, wow, wow. Absolutely, totally got that. Yeah, like we spoke about before, I'm sure you had some pretty way in there mystical experiences in your time. I've had mine, and I love, absolutely love, love, love playing in that arena of my own self. You know, I've had some where I was in other worlds, some where I was in angelic realms, and obviously, you know what that's like. And it just, you know, when you come back to home, when you come back to Earth, when you wake up, something profound happens to you or to a person after they had one of those experiences. Would you agree with that, sir?
Absolutely. What essentially happens is that you become aware that this life is nothing but a moment. The power that creates the dream will continue the dream. So there's really nothing for you to do. Just, you know, as my teacher used to say, is like, I became aware of this physical realm and I left it to look after itself. I don't have to worry about a thing. It just, everything's going to happen as it should. It's just a moment. I'm not saying that, you know, in the other program, in the From Choicelessness to Power, I kind of merge these two dualities, how to be responsible, completely take responsibility for everything in the world, and yet letting it go on one level and merging those two points together. So I'm not advocating irresponsibility, but in the spiritual realm, yeah, you're no longer worried about the personality and what is being experienced, because it just, in the ultimate sense, it doesn't mean anything. It's just an experience, and it will be forgotten 400, 500, 1,000 years from now. It will be like a dream that you had 20 years ago. Does it even matter? You don't even remember. So what? This is just another realm. This is just another dream. And even if you don't want to, you know, dive deep into spirituality, just consider your life a dream, just from a physical perspective. One meditation that I recommend is look at the night sky, because the night sky is a great field for imagination. And look at the planet Earth from millions of miles away. It's just going to be a dot. It's just, we're nothing but an atom in the body of the universe. We're so teeny, so small. Our life is so small, and it's going to happen so fast that it's just scary to even think that it's nothing. That nothingness brings fear, because, you know, on a physical level, the ego wants to survive. He wants,
you know,
even
becoming aware of doing that exercise that you mentioned, when a person begins to see themselves as insignificant, which such a meditation would bring about, it brings up fear, because in that moment, a part of you will die.
Absolutely. In Mithraism, or I don't like to call it Mithraism, in Mithra, we have a ceremony where you essentially perform your own ceremony, as if you're, what is it called when somebody dies? Memorial?
Memorial?
Yes.
Funeral?
Funeral. Yes, funeral. You conduct your own funeral, and you take important objects that are meaningful to you, you burn it all. You got to die to yourself in order to spiritually become awakened. The Buddha used to say, no person has ever entered enlightenment. And what he means by that is that you cannot have that concept that I'm this or that and enter the field of enlightenment. You got to get rid of that personality. And the only way you can get rid, not to get rid of it, but to transcend it, is to shift your focus and become more aware of your own awareness that's already in the background.
You had said earlier, and this reminds me of something I talked about a few weeks ago, is that when, let's say, a situation arises, and in this situation is a bunch of, let's say, well, just the fact that it's difficult implies that there's trouble, implies that there's density, implies that there's darkness. So just by simply becoming, and that doesn't mean be lazy and don't address your concern if it requires your physical actions, right? But as a practice, when a person looks at this situation that is dark in nature and brings the light of awareness to it by simply becoming aware, and awareness is light, this problem that one could have had become static in their life just simply doesn't assemble whatsoever, because light dispels the dark.
Absolutely. What that also does is, because you're not emotionally attached to the situation, and you may be emotionally attached, but you may have moments of clarity where that emotional attachment dissipates. So in those moments, you can see different choices that you may have. If you're emotionally attached, your viewpoint becomes myopic. So when you're detached, you may find many, many different answers to your problem. So to answer that question, yes, absolutely. Awareness is not just sitting idly like a vegetable. It's a very powerful state. And once you become aware of your choices, you can make the best possible choice in the moment and not be attached to the outcome.
Andre, we are slowly but surely coming to the top of the hour. Would you give out your contact information if you have any more you want to give out, but also leave us with a final thought?
Yes, my contact information is PersianAstrology.com. My final thought is that you spend the majority of your day taking care of your physical body. You go to the gym, you feed it, you drink water, you sleep, you go to the mall, you close it. You spend all your day taking care of your physical body. Why not taking a little bit of time every day to take care of your mind, your thought patterns, your awareness, your consciousness, the greater aspect of yourself? Why don't you, whatever works for you. I'm not necessarily advocating meditation for everyone, but at least the least thing you can do is take about 10 minutes in the morning, maybe 10 minutes in the evening, and just relax. Just let it all go. And consider life as a dream. And just experiment with that for a few weeks and see what happens. How does it change your outcome? How does it change your outlook? How does it affect your thought realm, your physical body, your relationship with others, and just see what happens. Just take a little bit of time every day. That's my only recommendation and my final word.
Andre, thank you for being here on Center of Light Radio, sir. I have waited, no kidding, I'm a year to have this moment with you, and I absolutely consumed all of it and enjoyed every bit of it.
I appreciate it. Thank you so much, Keith.
What's coming down the pike for you, sir?
Well, I'm actually currently working on a series of videos, short, because these days nobody wants to sit down and listen to a complicated audio program that's a few hours. So just short topics that may hopefully challenge you and make you think, and maybe you hopefully starting a nonprofit organization. Basically have a spiritual school of some sort.
Dig that. Again, I want to say thank you very much for being here. Wonderful guest on Center of Light Radio.
Thank you, Keith. Have a good day.
Take care. Everyone, Andre Atabaki, I really enjoyed this show. I waited for a year. No kidding. I waited for a year to talk to this phenomenal, enlightening gentleman. Next week on Center of Light Radio, for the third time, I mentioned his name. It's Mr. Derek Rydall, and we're going to be talking about his phenomenal book. I think it's number one in New York Times bestseller. It was, it's called Emergence, The Law of Emergence. And also one more announcement again about my friend Kenneth Pass, who was a guest here sometime recently on Center of Light Radio. If you go to centeroflightradio.com and look on the opening page, you're going to see a flying saucer fly across the screen. Kenneth was abducted when he was a young boy, 8-9 years old, whatever. And he was taken back 10,000 years in the past. He had some pretty powerful experiences with these extraterrestrials. It kind of pissed him off, upset him. And out of this reaction. He hid some of their technology somewhere in Arizona, wherever it is, I don't know. And Kenneth is a really cool cat. I really believe his story. I believe Kenneth. He's a very simple guy. That being said, he doesn't really have the means of transportation to get to Arizona. If my life was a little more free, you could bet I would be taking him on to Arizona to find some alien technology to bring it to the Hopi Indians. But anyway, my goal is to buy Kenneth a round-trip bus ticket. He'd probably stay there a couple of weeks at most. But my goal is to raise $500. So if you see that donation button right next to that spaceship on the opening page of centerlightradio.com, it allows you to donate, which you can. And we can raise money. Kenneth can go find this alien technology, bring it to the Hopi and or the Pueblo, come back. We have him as a guest on Center of Light Radio. See, that way we can all learn about what transpired on this journey that it's eating him up inside. He feels that he has to do this. And so if you can donate, we'd be appreciated. Look forward to seeing you next week with my guest, Mr. Derek Rydahl, Keith Anthony Blanchard here. Remember, when you lay down at night, you have nothing to do. As Mr. Andre Atabaki and I talked about tonight, just practice becoming aware, 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 aware. And one way you can do that is breathe yourself through the ceiling of thought through meditation. And when you are successful, you will know it, because you will find yourself in the profound, deafening silence of the cosmic life stream. Talk about your life will open up then in more ways you can possibly imagine. See you next week. Peace, love, and light. My name is Keith Anthony Blanchard. Ease into bliss. Inside.